In the previous movie, we used the power of loops and variables to populate our graveyard with humans and zombies. In this movie, we'll use vectors to figure out how close the zombies are to the humans and script their interaction. Open the scene, Zombie Apocalypse, Part 4, Start. Now, anyone who's seen a zombie movie knows exactly what happens when a human gets near a zombie. He inevitably becomes another zombie. In our simulation, we'll accomplish this by measuring the distance from a zombie to each human. If the zombie is close enough, replace that human with a new zombie. We'll then repeat this for every zombie in the scene. If you recall from the previous movie, our loop currently pulls each element in the variable array $objects one at a time and puts it on a table for us to examine. Now we want to compare whatever is on $A to every other object left in $objects. How can we do this? With a loop inside a loop. Open the expression editor and select your move expression. Add the following structure inside our loop. Think of this as adding a second table next to the first one, where we can cycle through everything in $objects to get a good look at them side by side. In the script, you can also start to see why our indentations are important. It allows us to see our looping structures more easily. So, now that we have a structure set up to compare objects, we need to figure out what we want to compare. We're not really interested in the case when both objects are humans. Nor are we interested when they're both zombies either. What we're really interested in is whether one is a human and one is a zombie. But how do we really know if an object is a human or a zombie? We'll simply add a new attribute to tell us. Select your original human object and add the attribute zombified. We're going to make this a Boolean value, which means it can only be yes or no. Now do the same for the original zombie. For the zombie in particular, turn on the zombified attribute. Run the script you made in the previous movie to create a fresh batch of humans and zombies. Notice that they all have the new zombified attribute. Now we can refer to this attribute in our script. First, let's create two variables to store our attributes for comparison. You may remember that our zombified attribute is a Boolean type, but Booleans can be represented by integers as well. 0 is no, and 1 is yes. As you can see, we are initially assuming both objects are human. Now, let's set our variables to the zombified attribute's actual values. Now that we know whether $A and $B are zombies, we can use if statements to compare them. First, let's take care of the case when they're both humans or both zombies. This says that if both $A and $B are true, both zombies, or false, both humans, then we want to break out of this loop iteration and go to the next. It should be noted that the double equal sign denotes a comparison of two values. A single equal sign denotes assignment. For example, x equals 1 plus 1 denotes we are assigning x the value of 1 plus 1. Let's take a moment to comment this, so that we always know what this if statement is doing. Comments, denoted by double slashes, are lines that are ignored by Maya when running the script. They are useful for writing yourself reminders or to leave explanations for sections of script. They are especially useful if you're working collaboratively on a script with others. Now let's take care of the case where one is a zombie and the other is a human. Since we're looping through all the objects in the scene, we're going to get duplicate comparisons. For example, comparing zombie 1 to human 1, and then human 1 to zombie 1. We don't need to compare the same pair of characters twice, so this line ensures that we only act when $A is a zombie and $B is a human. Comparing them the opposite way is equally valid. The double ampersand sign indicates that both conditions must be fulfilled for us to enter into this if statement. In order to figure out if our zombie is close enough to a human to turn him into a new zombie, we need to figure out the distance between them. To do this, we'll calculate the vector from one to the other. If you think of a 3D grid, a vector is basically a line segment pointing from one coordinate to the other. However, since our characters don't move in the y-axis, we are actually only dealing with a vector in x and z. Once we have this vector, we can use Maya's built-in commands to find its length. First, we need our start and end coordinates. Input the following code. This creates two vectors and stores our zombie and human coordinates in them. Now create a third vector and assign it the difference between these two. The difference gives you the vector between them. Now we can use the Maya command, mag, to find the length of the vector, also known as the magnitude. $dist holds the distance from zombie $A to human $B. Now it is simply a matter of deciding if that distance is close enough, and if so, replacing our human $B with a zombie. First, create an if statement. This indicates that 135 units is close enough for the zombie to zombify a human. Next, let's delete the old human. This removes every child node below our human node, $B. Add the next line. This creates a new numbered zombie object by renaming the old human $B object. Why not just delete the human entirely and create a new zombie from scratch, you might ask? We want to make sure the zombie spawns in the exact same spot and orientation as the original human, values which are stored in its human group node. Now add the following lines. This sets the attributes to match those of the rest of the zombies. Now we just need to duplicate the zombie mesh and place it in our new zombie object. Now you can laugh sinisterly as the doomed humans are slowly transformed one by one, into mindless zombies. You'll notice that each time a new zombie is created, Maya selects it automatically. We can fix this with a single line of code in the transformation statement to clear the selection. Now save your scene and play it to completion. When there aren't any humans left, a problem suddenly becomes apparent. All your humans are gone. That means that if you try to run your initialization script again, you'll get an error because there aren't any humans left to duplicate. Conceptually, this is a big problem. Ideally, we'd want to have a single human and zombie that never change to act as our template for our duplicates. Reopen your saved file. Now rename your original human group object to original human group. Do the same for the zombie group. Since you're changing this node name, you will need to make a few changes in both your move expression and initialization script. If you get stuck, refer to the comments in the next movie's tutorial file for the appropriate changes and the explanation for them. Now, if you run your script, you'll see that the original human and zombie don't translate and also don't interact with the human-zombie duplicates. You can hide your template human and zombie by selecting them and pressing Ctrl-H. Now you can run the initialization script as many times as you want. Although the script works, you'll still get errors when humans turn into zombies. We'll address this in the next movie when we make our script a little more robust and refine our humans' reaction to the zombies.